have 3 more short case, then instruments, specimens and operative procedures by different faculty. If the postgraduates can answer in 2-3 seconds, they can answer. What's the standard screening for breast cancer? Now, which age it should start? In between 25 to 39 years, there is no guideline. NCCN guideline says only clinical encounter or clinical examination. In women 40 years and older, what's the screening? Faster. Annual mammogram, okay? What's the age limit? What's the highest age limit you should do? These are not mine, these are NCCN guidelines which are accepted by many people. There is no age, there is no guideline. Many people do till 65 years. There was a question about the BRCA1 and BRCA2. When do you do risk reducing mastectomy? When do you do risk reducing mastectomy? This is a guideline recommendation. Okay? You know Angelina Jolie has got the high risk patient with BRCA1, BRCA2. It increases the risk by 56 to 84% with informed consent. It is not mandatory to do. It's with informed consent. So these people you can do, and if RRM will decrease the risk by 90%. 10% still doesn't decrease the risk. Okay. Coming to invasive, there's a lot of hype about PET CT. Is PET CT the gold standard in breast cancer staging? No. No, never. PET CT is not the gold standard. It's not recommended as a guideline. It's grossly misused by many corporates and other hospitals. Okay, in stage 1-2B, the standard workup, complete blood picture, comprehensive metabolic panel, and additional studies only if symptoms are there. For example, if pulmonary symptoms are there, then CT scan chest. If bone symptoms are there or alkaline phosphatase elevated, then bone scan. So as far as we are concerned, I don't know the exam, your post-grad exam, most of the time we don't do any bone scan or CT lung without symptoms. In stage 1-2B, you should all know TNM staging is changing rapidly. And 2017, another staging has come with some mild modifications. And abdomen and pelvic CT scan or MRI also is based on the symptoms. So standard recommendation, no PET CT in the stage 1-2B. Okay, and just CT also not standard. Only if pulmonary symptoms are present, it should be done. Even in stage 3A, that because these things are put because this, some people operate this case, some people give pre-op chemotherapy. So stage 3A, again, complete blood picture. Then metabolic panel, comprehensive metabolic panel, and just diagnostic CT with contrast, abdominal CT plus or minus pelvic CT, bone scan is category 2B. There are, you know, category 1, 2, 3 by the guidelines, by recommendation. We follow category 1 recommendation. So PET scan is category 2B or optional. It's not standard even in stage 3A unless symptoms are there. So these are the guidelines. So when do we advocate PET CT? Use of PET CT is not routinely indicated in stage 1, 2 or operable 3. That is very important. Because grossly, even we do sometimes out of pressure, because many people read internet and ask for it, but otherwise it's not standard. Because high false negative rate for tumors less than 1 cm and low grade tumors. And even actually node metastases are not detected properly in the PET CT. That's the reason we don't advocate PET scan routinely. And ductal carcinoma in situ, what's the treatment, standard treatment? Ductal carcinoma in situ. And in this exam, lumpectomy?
Yes,
okay. Otherwise, if the patient is elderly?
MRM.
MRM or TM? Total?
Total.
Yeah. Okay, good. So lumpectomy with whole breast radiation with or without post to the tumor. That's category 1 recommendation. Then total mastectomy, if the patient doesn't want radiation and other things, we can always do. Even breast conservation treatment, whenever we tell patient, we should always tell radiation as a part of the PCT. We should not tell only rates of wide excision or conservation. So what's the margin? The margin is 1 mm in DCIS. Okay, less than that is called negative. I'm just putting small guidelines without discussion because I think there are a lot of short cases to be discussed. And always diagnosis, no FNAC, only core biopsy. Okay, remember, there's no FNAC for malignancy. And I think we'll go. Next case, what's the option of treatment for this? Stage 1, 2A, 2B. Category 1 recommendation. Yeah? You prepared breast, tell? what will you give patient option? I mean, just guideline, overview, it may be different for 70-year-old lady, for a young lady. What are the two options available?
Breast
conservation treatment and MRI or whatever. So breast conservation includes what? Lumpectomy with hormone radiation, okay? So options of surgery available, lumpectomy with surgical axillary staging. Presently, though we don't have much in Hyderabad, but sinusal node biopsy is the treatment for axillary management. That's why I have not written axillary clearance, I have written surgical axillary staging. If you have facility to do SLM, you should do SLM always. So these are the category one recommendation, and breast reconstruction can be done either primary or secondary as per the patient choice. What's the margin of excision defined NCCN guideline?
No incon tumor.
Where did you learn that? Okay, good. No ink on the tumor. That's the guideline. This is NCCN guideline. Okay, you can always go back. You can check it. It's online. You can check it. This is the margin. They have not defined any centimeters or anything. Sorry, sir.
On table. Give
1 centimeter
margin.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Mike. Sir, Mike.
Maybe you can chair the session, sir. You can chair the session. Please come, sir.
Please come, sir.
Very well. So usually we aim at 1 centimeter, the minimum of margin, which I told earlier. That is 10 centimeters.
If it is not understood properly, that will lead to catastrophe. So on table, we give 1 centimeter margin. And the pathologist assesses that, then question is, when will you say it is positive margin or negative margin? Inked margin is negative, it is negative margin. Inked margin is the periphery of the specimen you have sent. That's all. So you don't aim at giving 1 millimeter margin or thinking that inked margin will be negative. You have to give 1 centimeter margin on table in 3 dimensions. Okay?
So if margin is positive, what should we do? If it is possible still to preserve, you should do re-excision. Then don't think of mastectomy at the first instance. Is it not?
You can re-excise the margin.
Yeah.
Then you classify them whether it is a focally positive or diffuse positive. If it is focally positive and patient is still one species, you can go ahead with radiation therapy. Only if it is diffuse positive, then you convince the patient to do a mastectomy.
Yes. You are asking a lot of questions. So if you want to have a breast cancer, you give pre-op chemotherapy. Then suppose the tumor disappears completely, but the patient wants breast conservation. So what should you have done when the patient came to you initially? How will you localize? So sometimes we see that disease disappears totally, but the patient wants breast conservation. So what should you do? So we have a radio-guided clips applicator at that area of the center of the lesion. So you should always mark in case you want to do your medical oncology is good and drug response is good. So that is the, and one more thing, NCCN guideline says that the sentinel node biopsy is the standard, sir, now. But it's not being followed many centers.
But
so
what should we do? Not available.
Yeah, not available.
Not available.
It just cost actually 18 lakhs, that's all, yeah. The probe. But many of the time people
the problem don't. Is not only availability, but validation also.
Yeah.
We need lot of training.
Yes, but the guideline says it should be done now, and they don't say don't clear the. So
in
as
Indian,
of now,
in Indian guidelines, yeah. When it is not available.
ICMR guidelines.
Yeah, at level 1-2 clearance.
Yeah.
If there are no lymph nodes at level 2, you stop at level 1-2. What you don't want to do axillary clearance is lymphedema. That is the main problem.
Yes.
The proper level 1-2 clearance is done. Lymphedema chance are only 5%.
So
with sentinel node, it is still 3-4%, but so not much different. Only in cases where you do a complete axillary dissection up to level 3, the lymphedema goes to 15%. So level 1-2 clearance with proper margins, taking all precautions, your lymphedema rate is almost comparable to sentinel node biopsy.
One question.
Srinivas sir is a walking encyclopedia of oncology. He always brushes up knowledge.
One question, sir.
Yes.
Sentinel lymph node is negative.
Yes.
Is there any indication still axillary clearance is
no.
to be done?
No. If the sentinel lymph node is identified and it is negative, there is absolutely no indication.
No indication.
And even if it is positive, the one or two nodes positive, and if micrometastasis are there, still you can avoid axillary dissection up to 2 nodes.
Somewhere I read,
yeah.
In high risk group, when the tumor is more than 1 centimeter in size, it's mandated to do axillary clearance in spite of a sentinel lymph node negative. Is
no,
it true?
No, sir.
Then why should you do sentinel node at all?
No, sir. No negative.
Not anymore. High risk group.
No, whatever. No.
Whatever is the risk.
Right.
Axillary node is only for disease-free survival, not for overall survival, sir.
Okay.
So, the term that has been come now is not axillary clearance, surgical axillary staging. That can be, if you are an advanced center, you can be called SLN. If you are in a center where you don't have single node, you should tell level 1 to clearance, okay? Surgical axillary staging, that's the word that's being used. So, this can be identified by HEE or cytokeratin. Cytokeratin ISE scintillant is not being used many centers, it's only HEE which is being used, okay? Then axillary node, axillary lymph node clearance. The panel recommends level 1 to, as Srinivas had told, okay? Level 1 to clearance is a standard. These are all used, some, I think I won't go into details because it's trime is not there. And there is a guideline that says that 10 lymph nodes should be removed. If you are doing axillary nodes, 10 lymph nodes should be removed. This is from NCCN, okay? Remember that. Though it's arbitrary, it may change when you people become oncologists or start practicing. And what are the indication for level 3? I have written here, if it is gross, lymph nodes are there in level 1, 2. So I won't go into it. And contraindication is very important. Many of the people ask you these questions, okay? Contraindications for BCP. Anybody can tell, it will be a lot of time, I think. So use of radiation therapy during pregnancy, suspicious or malignant microcalcification all over the breast. These are all the complications I think most of you must have read. Then pre-op chemotherapy. Does pre-op chemotherapy improve survival? Is it done for improving survival or is it done to improve the margins of resection? No good. Very good. So overall survival benefit is not there. They found no difference in survival. Pre-op chemotherapy does not improve the survival. Is it not, sir?
Pre-op chemotherapy or adjuvant chemotherapy, that is post-op chemotherapy, the survival rates are same.
Yeah.
The pre-op chemotherapy in early breast cancer facilitates breast conservation.
This point is very important. Does not improve survival.
And in locally advanced, it reduces the local and regional recurrences. That's why we give pre-op chemotherapy and operate.
Pre-op chemotherapy, sir. Contraindication. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That is written. I have written that. It is downstaging. It's downstaging and make it resectable. It is written, sir. This is the indication. Yes, sir. If the patient tumor breast is small and but the tumor size is large, then most of the Indian women may have small breasts. So you want to reduce that, you can do that, sir.
There is a
category
called LOBC, sir. Not LABC, LOBC, large operable breast cancer. So,
we divide pre-op chemotherapy. I will end this, I think one or two slides, time is not there. You can divide pre-op chemotherapy for inoperable and operable breast cancer. Sir asked, Ravindra sir asked, same question has come now. So, for inoperable, these are the indications, inflammatory, bulky, N2, N3, all these are inoperable signs. We don't operate these cases. Nowadays, surgery is not the sanjeevani. Chemotherapy and radiation are very important. So, surgeon cannot raise his collar that he has done good surgery. And operable breast cancer, large primary tumor related to the breast size. It is not T3, T4 tumor. It is the size of the breast, size of the tumor. That is very important. So, these things, and sometimes node positive disease can become node negative with prion. I think I am not going to, these are all little complicated, sir. There are sometimes triple positive, triple negative. The targeted therapy is the future. Targeted therapy is growing tremendously. By the time you guys become oncologists or whatever practice, no? Targeted therapy would be target Herceptin, sir. Yeah, yes. As of now, HER new tube positive, trastuzumab is a category 1 recommendation. Category 1 recommendation. It should be given. It should be given. That is the category recommendation. And there are a lot of things that chemotherapy and endocrine should not be given together. I think your teachers will tell you endocrine therapy should follow chemotherapy. In pregnancy, so many things are there. I think that's a little different topic. I will end this, I think. And another entity called triple negative. Chemotherapy is always needed for these patients. Always, if the young patient comes, you should always do the cryopreservation of the ovary. And this is one more thing. If the young patient comes, if you are in a higher center, you should not directly start chemotherapy. You should give her an option of cryopreservation. Preserving women's ovaries is very important. We have a gynecologist, most of the centers have a gynecologist who preserves the. I think this thing, now there is a concept, it's not for 5 years alone, is it not, sir? Srinivas, sir. There is a concept change that is coming up. Yeah, and when I studied MS, it was 5 years. When I studied MCH, it was 5 years. Now there is a change, premenopausal and postmenopausal. This is a change that has happened. Okay, this thing. And what's menopause? 60 years is a menopause. Just like men now feel young even at 65. A lot of changes coming up in this thing. I think I'll end this. Thank you very much. Thank you so much, sir.